The Trans-Siberian Railway is arguably the backbone of Russia's transport infrastructure, stretching literally over 9,000 kilometers from Moscow's Yaroslavsky terminal. The six-day train ride passes through Perm, Tyumen, Omsk, Novosibirsk, Krasnoyarsk, Irkutsk, Ulan-Ude, branches off to the Chinese Eastern Railway, Khabarovsk, and finally ends in Vladivostok, only 125 kilometers from the border with North Korea. The railway was inaugurated in 1916 and is still the longest railway line in the world, but construction had taken a quarter of a century and was fraught with worker deaths, delays, and overall carnage that likely played a part in ending the very empire it sought to connect. Thanks to CuriosityStream for helping support the channel. If there is anything basically everyone knows about Russia, it's that Russia is big. Hell, I remember first learning about Russia as a kid just because it was the biggest country on Earth. And yet Siberia, which makes up 3/4 of Russia's landmass, is incredibly spread out, and many Siberian cities are some of the most remote in the world, even to this day. In the late 19th century, this posed a major problem to the Russian Empire, since it would often take months for commands from St. Petersburg to arrive on the Pacific coast, by which time these possessions could have theoretically been captured by Japan or another proximal power, which for keeping an empire together was obviously not ideal. Russia may have first conquered these lands to protect their heartland, but now found themselves needing a way to protect these territories. By this time, many countries had connected themselves by railway. Britain and Germany had already done so for decades, and the United States and Canada had also connected major population centers, including their transcontinental railroad projects, connecting the Atlantic with the Pacific in 1869 and 1885 respectively, each crowning achievements for these vast nations. At the time, Siberia was barely connected through roads barely suitable for stagecoaches, which obviously would not do for such a vast territory. Russia, however, was somewhat behind Western Europe and North America when it came to railway technology. Nonetheless, construction started in 1891 under orders from Tsar Nicholas II, the project managed by Sergei Vitsa. Vitsa divided the project into multiple sections, much like the similar projects undertaken in North America, but with a few differences. The most notable difference was that Russia wasn't nearly as rich as the US or Canada, meaning that Vitsa had to take drastic cost-cutting measures, notably with the rails themselves, which used rails made of less expensive iron on 2/3 the amount of ties normally used, and crossing rivers on bridges made of wood, with stone and iron only being used for the toughest river crossings. On these rails, trains were expected to only reach a top speed of around 25 kilometers an hour. The project experienced huge roadblocks, or I guess rail blocks, from swamps and mountains to completely half-assed land surveys. But one notable obstacle was Lake Baikal, being way too wide and deep to cross by bridge and too long to simply go around at this stage. The solution, therefore, was to build a boat that would ferry the train across the lake to continue its journey. The ferry that would undertake this task was the SS Baikal, and my god, was it a cluster f- right, I don't swear on the channel anymore. Cluster frick? Does that work? The SS Baikal was built in Newcastle upon Tyne in England, and although the vessel was very much seaworthy, there was one major problem. Lake Baikal is not connected to the sea, at least not in any helpful way. This meant that the ship that was to ferry trains had to itself be disassembled and put onto the existing sections of the Trans-Siberian to be hauled all the way over to Lake Baikal. Honestly though, just imagine that as a way to travel the world by train and boat. Unfortunately, although the vessel was indeed seaworthy, it was quickly proven that seaworthy and Lake Baikal worthy are two very different things indeed, since Lake Baikal was much rougher and froze much thicker than originally thought. With all this, it was eventually decided, screw this, let's just go around. After traversing Lake Baikal, the project was granted permission from China to build through Manchuria, splitting it into two sections in Harbin, with one finally finishing in Vladivostok, and the other going south to the warmer water port in Dalian, where Russia would station a crap ton of troops. This final section, however, would be revised later on after the Russo-Japanese War of 1904-05, prompting Russia to downgrade the amount of troops in Dalian. Wait, did I say downgrade? I meant upgrade. And build the Amur Railway, going around Manchuria instead. The railways therefore essentially had two opening dates, with the first edition in 1904 through Manchuria, and then the second in 1916, the railway this time wholly within Russian territory. This was right in the middle of World War I, however, and the Tsar barely had time to enjoy this new railroad before the revolutions of 1917, when Vladimir Lenin's Bolshevik Party stepped onto the scene. This prompted the Russian Civil War, in which the new railway would play a big part, even if it couldn't actually carry all that much at this point. The railway became a vital line of communication for the White Movement fighting against the Bolsheviks, until many important bridges were blown up, severing these delicate lines. During the Second World War, the railway initially served as an important link between Germany and Japan, since Germany's westward access was more or less cut off by the end of the 30s, until demonetizing boy himself, Rudolf Hodor, completely screwed this whole thing up by invading the Soviet Union. During this time, though, the railway had also been used by those trying to escape Germany, who used the railway to board US-bound boats in Vladivostok. It thus also became vital in connecting the US and the USSR, seeing as crossing the Atlantic was a lot more dangerous, as Germany and Britain would generally tend to sink ships from neutral countries heading toward their enemies, something Japan didn't generally do, more or less leaving Soviet ships alone. After the war, the line branched out to serve more Siberian cities not on the line, and was also rerouted along the Baikal-Amur main line. Today, the Trans-Siberian continues to serve its original purpose of connecting the cities and settlements of Siberia to the rest of Russia and the outside world, and now also serves as a beacon for YouTubers. A one-way ticket for the 6-day journey will set you back around 500 euros for a second-class bed. But the price is of course a lot lower if you just want to go from Moscow to Novosibirsk or Ulan-Ude to Krasnoyarsk, as is more often done. Even then, while today it might just be quicker and cheaper to fly the quick short 9-hour flight from Moscow to Vladivostok, the railway also plays an irreplaceable part in freight transport, effectively forming the backbone of all Siberian industry and connecting Russia's vast and expansive territory. When the weather gets crappy, surely you need things to do to pass the time indoors, right? However, maybe you also want the time you spend to be somewhat productive, but perhaps also not too strenuous either. If that just so happens to be the case, might I recommend today's sponsor, CuriosityStream, a documentary streaming service that's great to watch during bad weather like rain, snow, lightning, hail, tornadoes, volcanoes, asteroids, civil war, the death of the sun, Tuesday, or anything else nature can throw at you. That's because CuriosityStream has a library of thousands of different documentaries on space, history, nature, cuisine, culture, engineering, freaking dinosaurs, or basically anything else that might pique your interest. In fact, this week, I would recommend you watch the documentary Return to the Moon, all about how we will be returning to the moon and setting up colonies to become a multiplanetary species. CuriosityStream can of course be watched under any weather conditions, and if you go through the link below or through curiositystream.com/KhAnubis and use the code KhAnubis at checkout, you will get a month-long free trial, and then it's $2.99 per month on a monthly plan, or, get this, $19.99 for an entire year. How cheap is that? So again, be sure to use the code KhAnubis to get access to this amazing service, which will also go a long way in supporting the channel. Thanks for watching, and be sure to check out the merch store via KhAnubis.tv if you're interested. I just feel like I haven't really shouted it out in a while. Speaking of which, also be sure to join us on the Discord server, and push this video up on the algorithm by liking, sharing, and subscribing so you can learn something new every Sunday.